Termites are natives of the rainforests, but over several millennia, they migrated to desert regions as well. Ants have a tough exoskeleton, whereas termites do not. So they're very sensitive to changes in the environment temperature and humidity or even physical damage. So what they do is, they create these large mounds and they live underground. The work we've done is numerical simulations of airflow inside termite mounds. In a pair of human lungs, you'd suck in air through the trachea and then it would branch out. But in termite mounds, it works in just the opposite way. There's air coming in through these surface ducts, and these ducts merge into a central chimney. And inside the central chimney, there's air also rising from the bottom, so from the nursery where the termites reside. Because of a low pressure that develops on the leeward side of the termite mound, it creates a suction which sucks out the mixture of fresh and stale air. So that's how they maintain conditions which are similar to those in the rainforest, even in desert regions. We believe that understanding the mechanics of termite mounds would help bio-inspired HVAC system design, so heating, ventilation and air conditioning in very large residential and commercial buildings. We found this very cool, natural way of using atmospheric drafts and having it cool everything inside the structure. So we believe that, you know, we could draw inspiration from these termites.
So if you've never seen a star-nosed mole before, it can be quite shocking. Probably the most noticeable feature is that they have sort of like these fingers growing out of their nostrils, sort of like how a dog would sniff for prey on land. These do it at the bottom of swamps by blowing bubbles out of their nose and then sucking the bubbles back in really, really fast to pick up odors. The first problem is that the bubble would just float up. If you imagine having the nostrils at the center and then all these gaps all around it, if you blow the bubble is going to try to rise up through all the gaps at the same time. And then the surface tension of the bubble keeps the bubble in one piece. That keeps it centered on the nostril so that the mole can then suck it back up again. So this behavior, if you're not looking for it, then you're probably never going to see it, right? Because it happens in like a tenth of a second. What we're hoping is that if we better understand how this mole does this, connect it to other characteristics with the American water shrew and the Russian Desmond, then we can figure out sort of core characteristics that we can say, look at another mammal and be like, okay, you have what it takes to do underwater sniffing. Let's see if you can do it too. Because we suspect that this behavior might actually be much more common than we think.
I'm working on the mixing to prepare toothpaste. Basically, the most of the personal care product are non-Newtonian, yes. In case of non-Newtonian fluids, these have a viscosity that's changing with the shear rate, so with the stress basically that is applied. The idea is to study in general the interaction of solid particles in non-Newtonian matrices. We want to study all the process from the microstructure to the macrostructures. So they prepare this polymeric gel and they dilute it with glycerol because no water has to be used. So this is the main challenge because everything is very highly viscous, so it's very challenging then to have a good mixing between the two phases. Then all the additives are added, so solid particles to thicken the material or abrasives and all the flavors and surfactant. It seems like making a cake, actually.